rather settle for the authority of Scripture. How did God feel about Israel as he had to let them go? Oh, he cries, how can I give you up? How can I let you go? Why will you die? In the story of redemption, Ellen White tells that after Satan was expelled from heaven, he had regrets. He realized what he'd lost. He wondered if he could be taken back. He saw a loyal angel passing by. He asked if he could arrange an interview with Christ. You know the story. And Christ kindly granted an interview with Satan, his adversary, who had already disrupted heaven. And Satan wept, and his angels wept, the story says, as they begged to be taken back. Now, why didn't Christ take them back? The story goes on to say that then Jesus began to weep. What a scene! He wept over Satan and the fallen angels, and he explained to them it was not that God was unwilling to forgive, he's forgiveness personified, but that the enemy had so long indulged in habits of rebellious, illogical, and irresponsible thinking, that since God's only instrument of persuasion in the great controversy is truth spoken in love, and since Satan had now come to the place where he had lost the capacity to respond to healing truth spoken in love, his case, therefore, was beyond remedy. He could not be healed. And when Jesus told the devil that there was no hope for him, no chance he could be won by a last display of heavenly sympathy, was he angry with the devil? He wept over the devil. I am sure that at the end of the millennium, if we should be outside the city and look up and see Christ still in his human form, and we about to reap the natural consequences of our rebellious, disorderly living in his orderly universe, and his life-giving glory about to be unveiled and we be consumed by it, he'll not be angry with us. He's about to lose an untold number of people he's known so well. Most of all will Satan leave an eternal void in God's memory. He cries over the wicked, why will you die? How can I give you up? How can I let you go? Someday, as I understand it, God's people will be so settled into the truth, another word for the good news about God, that he can entrust them with gifts of persuasiveness and winsomeness under the power that we call the latter rain of the Holy Spirit, and they will somehow accomplish what seems utterly impossible at the present time. They will attract the attention of the whole world to the choices to be made about God, and the gospel will go to all the world, and the end will come. Couldn't you count on our gracious God to insist that the gospel must go to all the world before the end can come? He wouldn't ask anyone to go through those awesome experiences without sufficient information upon which to base an intelligent choice. When the good news has gone to the world, then Revelation 13 and 14 will be seen before us, and the whole world at one time will have decided, and God can say, it is done. And life can return to normal again, the way it was supposed to be in the beginning. But when our Creator comes back to restore this earth so that we can live in it as we were supposed to in the beginning, he doesn't come with his glory veiled. He comes in all his unveiled life-giving glory, and those who are out of harmony will be consumed. But this time, when God allows something to happen he could have allowed way back in eternity, but then it would have been misunderstood. When the wicked perish, no one will misunderstand and serve God from fear. The wicked have asked, they've even insisted on going their own way, and God has respected their decision. But when he gives them up and ceases to protect them, they reap the natural consequences of their disorderly living. The first angel comes with this everlasting good news that the devil has denied. Make up your minds, he says. It's the last message to the world. The second angel comes and says, the opposition is confusion. It's a lie. It's Babylon. It's Babel. It's all wrong. And the third angel says, You're free. But if you prefer Satan's law, you'll be caught up in the consequences. And they are unspeakable consequences, fearsome consequences. And God would spare you. What do you think of God talking so fearsomely in the third angel's message? Has he forgotten to be gracious in talking like that? If a father was walking with his son on a Sabbath afternoon near one of the precipices around PUC here, marvelous places to walk, and the son is getting near the edge, just a little one, needs a lot of protection, would it be all right for the father to call out after the son, "Stop, don't go any further, come back"? Do we object when God tries to protect us? What if the son should wander further over toward the edge, one step from the brink? What would you think of a father who'd raise his voice and shout, "Beware, watch out, son, I don't want you to die"? And people walking further down the trail would say, "Listen to that father bellowing. Why didn't he learn to be a civilized Christian?" And some people read the third angel's message and they let it turn them against God. It's because God doesn't want anybody to die that he raises his voice. Now, we know he'd much rather speak to us in the still, small voice at the mouth of the cave. He's got to be able to do that before we can be translated as Elijah was. But to the world not listening very well, he's willing to take them to Sinai. He's willing to thunder and bring lightning. And he raises his voice and says, "Why will you die?" He warns us. I understand it to be our privilege to take the third angel's message to the world, but to take it in the context of all 66 books so that it won't turn people against God as the doctrine of hell has done. Don't we understand the wrath of God and the final destruction? Can't we explain from the nature of the death of Christ what this death is like and how the Father feels about those he must give up? That's good news. And it's consistent with the whole picture. I understand it to be our distinctive mission in these last days to spread the good word, the whole word, the consequences of disobedience too, but the whole fair picture about our infinitely gracious God. Someday when that's done clearly and persuasively, the end will come. Forgive our loving Father in heaven. Surely we have great weight of evidence upon which to base the decision, surely all of us must have made by now, that thou art not the kind of person Satan has made thee out to be, but the kind of person Jesus pictured when he said, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." Surely it is only right, only grateful, even a great privilege for us to take this good news that we know to be true and share it with each other, and share it with the world outside. There are so many who are afraid of thee. There are so many, even among the saints, who obey thee, but in fear, obey thee for the wrong reason, and therefore cannot obey thee aright. Help us to see the kind of God thou really art, who wants us to feel free above all things else. But help us to understand how we can be obedient and in perfect harmony with thee and thy will, and feel wonderfully free at the same time. Grant that we may feel as Paul was, a debtor to others, to spread this good news. And may we soon have the winsomeness and persuasiveness of the Holy Spirit to present this message as it ought to be given. We pray in Jesus' name.